This video and its content has been rated G for general audiences, explored by LumiFusion, published to YouTube, and has been given the annual support from viewers like you. Where do I begin in this unpleasant episode? Well, I guess I better start off with the happy intro and work from there. So, yeah, let's do that. On the Farquhar branch line, Toby was finishing his final job of the day, and Percy was heading back to Farquhar Sheds with Annie and Clarabelle, whom he had collected from Natford, along with the occasional special coach only used on the weekdays for extra passengers going to work. Now the two engines were chilling in Farquhar Sheds when Thomas and Adam arrived. Adam had been helping out of the Farquhar quarry while Mavis was at the diesel works, who would be coming back the next day, so he was visiting the branch line crew before heading back to Vickerstown. Don't get me wrong, I love working in the massive station, but it's nice to have a change every once in a while. Just wish I didn't get so dusty, though.
Of course. We're always happy to have your help.
Say, guys, when I was helping out at Henry's Forest with Henry yesterday, Susie told me that our driver, Calvin, is currently celebrating Thanksgiving with his sister, who lives in New York.
Interesting. Hope he has fun.
Me too. I wish my siblings were still alive. I used to work with my brothers at the harbor at East Agon, but then moved to a small ferry on the island from Lower Osberg to Austin Inn before moving to the branch line after the ferry closed in the 50s, which is the same time all my brothers were scrapped.
Well, I was built with a variety of engines.
And the only siblings I have are Rusty and Midlander, who are narrow gauge engines, I think.
Don't worry, Toby. Even if you can't see your blood family, you've still got us.
I know.
Say, Thomas, do you have any siblings?
Well...
Are you alright, Thomas?
Oh, yeah. I'm fine. I just...
Just what?
Well, it's a long story. I don't want to talk about it.
Alright. Well, just know that I'm here for you.
Look, I can tell you're upset about God knows what. I can literally hear you gulping nervously. Go on, share some tears with us if you need to.
Look, guys, if Thomas doesn't want to talk about it, then it's fine by me.
No, it's okay. Basically, what I'm trying to say is I did have siblings, but one of them was a bit...
And this is the story that Thomas told. Back in the 1910s, the E2 engines were built at Brighton Works on the London, Brighton, and South Coast Railway between 1913 and 1916. 10 of them were built, including Thomas and his brother, Timothy. Not Timothy from the clay pits, but Timothy the Tank Engine. For many years, Timothy and Thomas worked together in the marshalling yards, both in Victoria Station and Devon Harbour.
Wow, Timothy, that was some hard day's work.
You could say that again, little bro.
You do realize we're the same age, right?
Well, lucky me. I'm a couple months ahead of you.
Whatever.
Oh, look at that. Tommy and Timmy sitting
back off!
Oh, whatever. You're just a rich kids anyway.
Man, I hate those big engines. Always picking on us tiny tank engines.
Don't listen to what everyone says about us. The only thing that matters is being useful and doing the best you can.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
There's gonna be worse times when my advice is useful, trust me.
Thomas and Timothy had a very strong relationship with each other, and were very happy for many years, along with the other tank engines. Until one day, 9 years later.
Ah, Timothy, I've got some big news for you.
What is it, sir?
Well, I got a call from a man named Sir Charles Topham Head from the Northwestern Railway on the island of Sodor. He said that he's in the of a station pilot at one of his stations, shunting trucks and coaches around. So we made a deal that you're going to be sold to Sodor.
I've heard of Sodor. Sounds like such a nice place. Am I going too?
I'm afraid you're not.
Wait, what?
You see, the controller of Sodor said he only needs one engine to work there. On a side note, you two seem to work together very well, and I'm extremely proud of the both of you. But the truth is, you two are a couple months older than Thomas, and have had more experience handling rolling stock. Not only that, but if I were to send both of you, it would be a waste of time and money for both railways. I know how you guys feel, but there's nothing else we can do. We'll talk about this more tonight.
I don't want you to go, Timothy. You're my brother.
But you're growing up to be a wonderful little engine, and I think it's time for you to go off on your own and use multiples of my inspiration for your hard work.
Say, remember that one time where that tank engine who was getting coal wouldn't listen to our warning about the hopper being broken? And his bunker got so overloaded that he was covered with coal dust?
That silly little one. It's not always good living in the past. Let's make the most of my remaining life here and create some new memories for our big finale.
And so that's what we did, before Timothy left for Sodor for the following week. However, after his arrival, he proved to be just as useful as he was at the old harbor, and he was given the number one. He enjoyed his new railway with new friends, but did miss me as well. So occasionally, our drivers would write letters to each other, and we both became pen pals. We both were doing fine with ourselves, but we still hoped that one day we would see each other in person again.
Wow, that sounds nice, but where's the bad part?
Percy?
Yes, Thomas?
Remember that ghost story you told me years ago, with the tank engine falling off, and the quote, "And every year on the date of the accident, it runs again as a warning to others."
Oh yeah, an old driver of mine told me that many years ago, and he did tell me it was a true story. Wait, does that mean...
You're about to find out, but not in a devilish way.
Well, we all know this service. The Midnight Blue Engine Express. Every evening around 6, Edward and Gordon pull two fast trains from Natford to Vicarstown non-stop. However, there are different routes. Gordon leaves first at 6:25 with the express for the main line. Then, Edward falls in 5 minutes later at 6:30 with his train for the branch line. However, that night, it was one of those nights where Edward was getting a bit old and in need of less work.
The drivers won't choose you again. They want big, strong engines like us.
So Timothy was asked to take his place. It was a peaceful evening, with no wars at all, as British society was fighting in other parts of the UK instead during World War II.
Now remember, Timothy, this is not like a normal passenger run or a freight train. You gotta focus no matter how tired you are, and you gotta be careful in the dark as well.
Don't worry, Gordon. Edward told me everything. I promise to be careful.
Five minutes later.
I'm coming for you, Gordon.
Oh, Timothy, what will we do about you?
Unfortunately, although they mentioned it in a funny way, Timothy's crew were about to get their answer. As of down the line, Timothy puffed along, and for a while, he was doing great. Until they head towards Gordon's Hill.
Come on.
Stay, old boy. Hang in there.
Eventually, he made it to the crest. But that's when trouble slowly began.
Phew! I could feel the wind rushing by me, but we're going a little fast.
Wait, what?
What's wrong, driver?
The brakes aren't working for some reason. I pulled on the lever twice, but...
Hey, let me try. Wait, if this lever doesn't work, this means...
Help! Runaway truck!
There must be something wrong with his braking system.
Just beyond Marin was a viaduct that had recently gained some rotten sleepers on the left rails.
Let's jump out of here while we got the chance before we get killed.
Right.
Crew? What the...
Timothy! No!
Ah! Well, that takes care of that.
Will you save your bloody mouth for when we're not about to get through the court? Oh, God. And the passengers. Society is going to kill us.
Fortunately, it was neither the driver nor fireman's fault. Timothy just had some faulty brakes, and his crew had saved their lives just in time by jumping clear from his cab. But as for Timothy and the passengers, it was a different story. For a little while, the railway fell into some hard times. Sir Tomhat the First lost a lot of money, so while the railway was closed for the rest of the month, he sold most of his engines in order to receive a tiny bit of debt coverage. The only engines he didn't sell were Edward, Henry, and Gordon. Sir Tom Hatt used a tiny bit of money to purchase a mixed traffic engine named James, and the railway slowly went back uphill. One year later in 1945, the same year that Wilbert Audrey had created the first railway series book, one year after Timothy's passing, Thomas the Tank Engine was purchased from the LBSCR Railway. He had been told that Sir Tom Hatt the First was able to get some money back and had enough to purchase a new station pilot. Thomas had decided to go there to honor Timothy and his legacy and to be the next step in his career.
You're going to honor your brother with great respect as the new number one tank engine counterpart.
Speaking of his brother, I forgot to mention that after the incident, Timothy was turned into a statue at Tidmouth Sheds, and he remained there for a couple decades. He had been given the number zero as a way of saying that a new number one would someday take his place. But due to some environmental pollution, the statue was turned into a ditch, and he was left there to rust, up until Gordon's accident. After Sir Tom had noticed it, he had no choice but to put Timothy's body in the scrapyard, and he was left there to this day, never to be seen again. Holy crud! I don't even know what to say!
That's terrible, Thomas!
I know. And don't get me wrong, I love it here on Sodor, and I'm not really that upset anymore, although I still think about him sometimes. I've moved into a variety of other things that make me the really useful engine I am today. But you know what hurts the most? The way his story is used on Halloween. Some people say he was this demon engine, or he purposely ruined his crew and passengers' lives. I know they're not trying to disrespect him, but it's still horrible to know that he's something being used as some creepy, insane devil. It's bad enough that he's dead, but it's even worse that people use him as some sort of joke. I sometimes think about him, and I wish his tale was just a story. Not some R-rated tale about a monster. I miss him so much.
Percy, Toby, and Adam felt terrible. They had never seen their number one friend so upset before. They stayed silent for a minute as Thomas expressed his emotions.
Okay. I'm good now. Sorry you had to see that.
It's fine, Thomas. You should never be afraid to express your feelings because we're here for you when you need to. Wait a minute.
One of my old drivers a couple decades ago told me about a scary ghost engine who fell off a viaduct on the mainland. I even pranked Thomas after the incident with flour. Wanna tell them, Thomas?
I think I know why you and the other engines were worried on Halloween a few weeks ago. You and Timothy are the same class, and they didn't want to be upset. I'm so sorry for reminding you, Thomas.
It's okay, Percy.
I'm guessing you were too uncomfortable to tell us sooner, right?
Bingo, Adam. Bingo. But I do feel a lot better now, telling you guys about it. Thank you for understanding. I'll never forget how kind you were to me.
Of course. That is what wise ones do.
I think Tim would be very proud of you, man. Don't get too upset with how people explain his story, because you're still a really useful engine, with or without your brother. And his legacy lives with you in the past, present, and future.
Three cheers for Thomas!
And all three engines whistled and honked happily together, especially Percy. Although he did feel bad about Timothy ending up at the scrapyard, so he raced off to talk to Sir Tom Hatt. Percy found Sir Tom Hatt the Fourth at Knapford and explained the whole thing. Sir Tom Hatt listened with content and decided to contact the museum in Vickerstown, where a not-so-rusted tank engine from the scrapyard was painted as Timothy, with a plaque saying, 100 years since service on Sodor, 1922 to 2022. It wasn't the former brother of Thomas, but hey, it was better than nothing.
This is the statue of Timothy.
Oi, is that really a statue of yourself?
And now, whenever Thomas thinks about his brother, he thinks of him as an incredible example of being a really useful engine.
Grandpa fought in World War II. He was such a noble dude. I can't even finish school. The world's smallest violin really needs an audience. So if I do not find somebody soon, I'll blow up into smithereens and spew my tiny symphony all up and down a city street while trying to put my mind at ease. Like finishing this melody, this feels like a necessity. So this could be the death of me, or maybe just a better me. So let me play my violin for you.
Psst, Thomas. You did the right thing, Thomas. One of the reasons why I miss you. I love you, Thomas.